Madam President, I suppose we were all shocked when Customs and Border Protection announced that more than 103,000 people illegally crossed our southern border in March. In April, we couldn't believe it when that number jumped to more than 109,000. And now we are in complete disbelief that in May, more than 144,000 people illegally crossed our southern border. I found it interesting that in comments by one of the presidential candidates running on the other side of the aisle, Bernie Sanders, who according to Axios is running second to Joe Biden in the 2020 Democratic primary polls, he called what is happening at the border now a, quote, serious problem, but not a crisis. When asked what more urgent crises there may be, he said, well, that's an issue we have to deal with, but the issue of climate change is a more serious crisis. He mentioned that among other items. Senator Sanders finds himself in disagreement, I suppose, with President Barack Obama, who in 2014 called what is happening at the border, where the numbers were far lower, he called it a humanitarian and security crisis. And Mr. President Obama's Secretary of the Department of Homeland Security, Jay Johnson, disagrees with Senator Sanders. He said there's a crisis at the southern border that needs the urgent attention of Congress. As it turns out, it's something that Congress itself is capable of addressing, but so far has refused any efforts to try to come up with a compromise piece of language that would deal with this ongoing humanitarian and security crisis. Vice President Pence's chief of staff said, as opposed to bellyaching about the actions of the president and taking to actually secure the border, it would be nice if they put as much energy into actually fixing the problem legislatively. I couldn't agree more with the vice president's spokesman or chief of staff in the remarks that he made. But in May of 2019, this was the third month in a row in which the number of individuals who crossed the border illegally was in six figures, a trend that we haven't seen since 2006, when the yearly total topped more than a million. I wouldn't be surprised if we hit that annual total again this year. Since the beginning of October, Customs and Border Protection has encountered more than 667,000 illegal border crossers, making this the first time in a decade that we've exceeded 500,000 apprehensions in a year. And don't forget, we still have 5 months to go. A government spokesman said last week, we are experiencing a system-wide emergency that is severely impacting our workforce, facilities, and resources. A system-wide emergency, he called it. So this isn't a manufactured crisis, as we heard a few months ago by some of our Democratic friends and colleagues. This is not a political stunt. Our Democratic colleagues continue to pretend that there is not a problem. In the face of rapidly dwindling funds and resources to manage the thousands of people in Customs and Border Protection's custody, our Democratic colleagues won't even provide additional funding to help the officers and agents who are working day and night to safeguard our border and to care for the migrants in their custody. I hope this recent data will force our Democratic colleagues to recognize the reality that this crisis is happening and it's growing. Even the editorial board of the New York Times, never quick to agree with President Trump or Republicans, they say it's time to do something about it. In an editorial in today's paper, they said, well, when will Congress get serious about the suffering at the border? And Madam President, I would ask unanimous consent that this editorial be put in the record following my remarks.
Without objection.
Reading an excerpt from the editorial of the New York Times editorial board, they said, unequipped to deal with the crush, border facilities and migrant shelters are dangerously overcrowded, and the staff is overburdened. Dysfunction, disease, and even death are a growing reality. We are in a full-blown emergency, and I cannot say this any stronger. The system is broken, the acting Commissioner of Customs and Border Protection, John Sanders, said. The editorial goes on to say, in short, it's time for Congress to stop the dithering and pass emergency funding to deal with this nightmare. Madam President, when the President announced his intention to impose new tariffs on Mexico, trying to bring them to the bargaining table to make sure that it stood up its efforts to try to prevent this flow of humanity from Central America, there were many people who questioned the use of that negotiating tool. I, for one, was concerned that it would have certainly unintended effects. But this is something that the President would never have had to do if members of Congress on the other side of the aisle would simply work with us to provide a legislative solution, and certainly if Democrats would work with Republicans to provide the emergency funding that is so urgently needed for this humanitarian crisis. Thankfully, the President was successful in his negotiations with the Mexican government, and now we'll see whether that 144,000 number in May actually begins to come down. That will be the best evidence whether Mexico's agreement with U.S. negotiators actually is providing concrete results. Yes, Madam President, it's time to put politics aside and start discussing real solutions. Now, there are no quick fixes, we know, when it comes to improving the situation at the border. It's going to require a long-term commitment by Congress and the administration, as well as our Mexican and Central American counterparts. Part of that commitment involves making physical improvements along the border and investing in infrastructure, personnel, and technology. It's the three-pronged approach that experts have repeatedly told me is needed to be successful, and it's exactly what Congress ought to be all about providing. But we can't just put up a strong physical defense and call it a day. We need to devote a great deal of time and effort to making improvements to reduce both the push factors from these Central American countries and the pull factors, which encourage these migrants to come to the United States in these kinds of incredible numbers. Along with my friend and colleague Henry Cuellar, who happens to be a Democrat in the House of Representatives, we've introduced a bill called the HUMANE Act, which would help us begin to reduce the pull factors and improve the way we process people who seek asylum here in the United States. The HUMANE Act would close a major loophole, the Flores Settlement Agreement, which is often abused and exploited by the human smugglers. This well-intentioned agreement was made so unaccompanied alien children could not be detained for more than 20 days. But a flawed court ruling subsequently to that imposed the same 20-day time limit on families traveling together. Let me tell you, the people who are illegally entering our country are not fools. They know our laws, and they know how to get around them, as do the people getting rich, moving people from Central America across Mexico into the United States, the human smugglers. These criminal enterprises know that if individuals travel alone, they'll be detained and eventually return to their home country, especially if you're a single adult. But if you're traveling with a child, the situation unfolds quite differently. After 20 days, they're released from detention and told to return for a court date that is who knows how many months or years in the future. And guess what? Many of them disappear into the great American landscape and never show up for that court date. Of the more than 144,000 people who illegally crossed our southern border last month, 69% were either unaccompanied children or part of a family. We don't know if these are legitimate families or if the child is traveling with a human smuggler or human trafficker. What we do know is that children are often abused or sexually assaulted on the way here, and many arrive at our border in critical health. Now, it's our responsibility to protect all the children in our custody, whether they are alone, with a legitimate family member, or a criminal. But the Humane Act would clarify that the 20-day limit applies only to those children. Family units would no longer receive the same treatment, which would deter criminals, smugglers, and traffickers from exploiting children as a free ticket into the United States. There simply has to be some sort of deterrence, and the only deterrence in this context is to detain these individuals until they can appear in front of an immigration judge and make their claim for asylum. The vast majority of claimants for asylum are not ultimately successful, but if they are released into the great American countryside, they never show up again for their court hearing and essentially circumvent our laws and exploit those loopholes. In addition, the Humane Act would provide protections for children like DNA tests to ensure that they're actually traveling with a biological parent. It would prevent children from being released into the custody of a sex offender or human trafficker. I know these seem like common sense reforms, ones that could protect vulnerable children and ensure that our laws aren't abused, and finally begin to reinstate the integrity of our legal immigration system. But that's not what is happening right now in the absence of congressional action. There are additional common sense measures in the Humane Act, like streamlining the processing of migrants, adding more customs and border protection personnel, and training for those who work with these migrant children. As I said earlier, it's important to note that this is the only bill that has bipartisan support. It's not a sweeping reform that will immediately fix every problem along our border, but it's an important place to start. I believe there's more we need to do here at home to stem the crisis, but the truth is we can't do it alone. We need to work with Central American countries, where the vast majority of these migrants are coming from, to help them build stronger and safer governments and countries. We can't do it for them, but we can help. We also need additional support from our southern neighbor, the country of Mexico. I agree with President Trump that Mexico must do more to prevent the mass migration of Central Americans traveling across their country en route to the United States. So I commend the President, the administration, and the Mexican government for working together to come up with a solution that will help stem the flow of migrants at our southern border, as well as avoid the costly economic mistake of additional tariffs. The fact is, we can achieve border security without compromising our economic security. The two are not mutually exclusive. Let me say that one more time. We can achieve border security without compromising our economic security. The two are not mutually exclusive. I'm eager to continue our work here in Congress to improve our immigration system in a way that prioritizes both physical and economic security. And I hope our colleagues on the other side of the aisle will join me and join us in that effort. Madam President, I would yield the floor and note the absence of a...